Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. And we've received apologies from Stephanie Callaghan. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? I don't have that. Thanks for that. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the committee's annual review of MPF4 from the Minister for Public Finance. And the Minister is joined by Fiona Simpson, who's the Chief Planning Officer, Director of Planning, Architecture and Regeneration, and Andy Kinnaird, who is the Head of Transforming Planning at the Planning, Architecture and Regeneration Division at the Scottish Government. And I welcome the Minister to his first meeting in his new role, and we look forward to working with you. And before we move to questions, I just wanted to remind members and those participating in today's session that there are current active legal proceedings concerning the interpretation of MPF4 policies and the interaction between these policies and existing local plans. Under this Parliament standing orders, a member may not, in the proceedings of the Parliament, refer to any matter in relation to which legal proceedings are active, except to the extent permitted by the presiding officer. And whilst we do not wish discussion debate to be unduly restricted today, I would ask members and witnesses to avoid referencing specific matters that are currently before the courts. And I would like to begin by inviting the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Committee. It's good to be back on the other side of the table, and I welcome the opportunity to give evidence to the Committee today on National Planning Framework 4 and look forward to discussing it with you. As you know, I've only very recently taken on responsibility for planning. However, as Minister for Public Finance, I understand the significant contribution planning can make to the key priorities of the new First Minister, and I'm looking forward very much to my new role. Planning can be challenging, but that is also what makes it so interesting and, of course, so very important to all of us. National Planning Framework 4 is now the cornerstone of our new planning system. It sets a clear and ambitious future for all stakeholders to work collectively together to deliver. It gives clear support for good quality development in the right locations when they are needed. And it's more than a high-level vision. The plan is backed up by national planning policies and national developments. We are committed to making NPF4 work in practice. It's not just a plan or an aspiration, but a firm commitment to delivering positive change. NPF4 has been in place for a little over a year now, and it's helpful that the committee is now taking stock of where we have got to. A lot has happened over the last year. In the autumn, we published the second iteration of a delivery programme for NPF4, and it includes a wide range of actions that we've already delivered and continue to take forward ourselves and in partnership with others. And this is the first national planning framework to have statutory development plan status. This makes it very influential in the planning process, but is designed to work together with local development plans which ensure local circumstances are taken into account. Planning authorities are now beginning to prepare new local development plans, and they will be instrumental in taking forward NPF4 in different parts of the country in a way which responds to each of their unique challenges and opportunities. Now, I know planning authorities and developers have been working hard to take NPF4 forward, and it's good to hear that communities are also very interested in it. But implementation will take time, and we're working together to understand how the policy should be applied in practice. I know that the planning profession recognises the scale of both the challenges and opportunities we have in front of us. Throughout the last year, we have worked closely with stakeholders to identify areas where there has been debate about how the policy should be applied in practice. This includes policies on housing, rural housing and flooding. Climate change and biodiversity have also been an important focus for guidelines and good practice. There will always be different and often opposing views on development proposals as well as planning policies. And often policies may appear to pull in different directions, but planning is all about taking into account all relevant considerations and weighing them up to make sound decisions. A number of those given evidence have indicated that it's still early days for NPF4, and there's no doubt that there's been a significant change to the operation of the planning system in Scotland. And development timescales means, of course, that it takes some considerable time to see the impact of planning policies on the ground. However, it's clear that change is happening, and those changes will help to ensure that our long-term spatial vision is realised in the future. This committee, of course, played an important role in shaping NPF4. A lot of work went into it, and your approach was open, positive and inclusive. And, of course, the Parliament as a whole was responsible for approving it. In turn, over the past year, NPF4 has helped to promote a more positive approach to planning, where planners are proactively planning our places rather than just acting as reactive regulators. I hope that positivity and can-do attitude will continue over the coming year as we continue to put in place further tools and work together to deliver economic growth and support a just transition to net zero. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much for that. I've got a couple of questions. I think I'm just going to package it all up. So it's a bit of a kind of looking back, and as we all understand, this is kind of early days on NPF4. But looking back, it would be interesting to hear any particular highlights from the 14 months since we adopted NPF4 that you'd like to outline and highlight to committee. I know in your opening statement you did mention a few things, but maybe some pick out some pieces there that would be good for us to be aware of. But then also, what are you planning to do? What's the Scottish Government planning to do over the next 12 months to support the delivery of NPF4 policy priorities? So it's sort of an opening question, a couple of pieces to an opening question that will kind of set the scene for the session.
Absolutely. Thanks for that question, Convener. I think what I'd like to mention is the recognition that NPF4 has gained. Winning the Planning to Address Climate Change Award at the UK Level Planning Awards last summer. The UK Climate Change Committee, in its Adaption Progress Report of November 2023, stated that NPF4 is a significant step forward in delivering adaption, and it's won a number of other awards at a UK level. So we're very delighted about that. It's recognised in many ways as being groundbreaking in its approach. Clearly, of course, as we recognise, it's early days, but it's been very well accepted by the planning community, and there's significant work happening, as we know, to line up local development plans with the approach within NPF4. And I think, obviously, we won't go into the details of it, but the recent court case, I think, has helped to clarify some aspects of that, and the fact that we've won that case, of course, pending appeal, I think gives us confidence that NPF4 is pointing in the right direction in terms of what it needs to deliver. In terms of the issues that need to be focused on, the team have got a very thorough and impressive delivery plan that they're working through, which is RAG rated, and that's been very effective in giving an overview of what areas of focus are required. And there's clearly quite a bit of work happening on local development plans. There's a number of areas, for example, the master consenting areas, further work on compulsory purchase orders, work on infrastructure levy that are in the pipeline and being considered. And I think the planning community and local communities indeed become more familiar with NPF4, I think we expect to see more community level engagement as well, which would be very, very encouraging.
Thanks. I'm just going to ask a little bit of detail, because I do notice that there is this master consents plan consultation happening at the moment, and I wondered, and maybe this is a bit too detailed for you, Ivan, but How is that going to work with the NPF4, the master? How do you see that working once it's, I mean, obviously it's going through a consultation process and you're going to get a result and some feedback on that, but how's that going to work or support NPF4 delivery?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, the master consent areas is one of the consultations that's out just now, and the concept there is that you're identifying an area where there is some of the work's already been done to say that you've got an area where the planning process can be a bit easier and a bit more a bit faster to implement. So it's about identifying where those areas would be, working with local authorities and local communities, and then ensuring that, particularly in rural areas, you've got less hurdles, if you like, because you've done a lot of the groundwork previously to understand what's permissible. But if you want any more detail, I think Andy can give you a bit more on the specifics.
Sure, just say a bit more. So the consultation itself is largely about the procedural aspects to how a planning authority would take forward a master plan consent area. But the thrust of what they're about is much more as a delivery tool, so to help authorities working with industry partners where appropriate to deliver on what they consider to be their priority developments for their areas. And that could be a lot of different things. It may be about delivering housing, it may be about delivering industry. Rural homes is another area where we see opportunities for them, but also particularly as a tool to support town centre regeneration projects as well. So it can be used as a tool to support the delivery of a local development plan, so potentially for allocated sites or to meet the policies in the LDP. But it's also flexible enough that if new priorities are emerging out with the development plan cycle, then sites could still be brought forward to grant these effectively upfront planning and other consents.
How does it work? How does the master consent area work with the LDP?
So
how do they fit together?
Yeah. So it can work with or not necessarily with the LDP. So if for example, the LDP identifies a particular development that wants to see happen on a site, then you can use the master plan consent area effectively to sort of de-risk some of the process around that. That means the planning authority takes the work forward to look at the detail of the development they want delivered and sort of grant the consents with the conditions that they want. In effect, that helps incentivise investors as well, knowing that that risk has gone out of the system.
OK, great. Thanks very much for that, going into that detail. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey, who's got a number of questions.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister and colleagues. Ivan, the updated delivery programme that I think you referenced in your opening remarks, of course, it's very early days, we all know that, but we've got plenty of documents and so on and working groups established, which are an inevitable requirement as we deliver a huge programme like this. But could you say a wee bit more about how the government plans to monitor outcomes and impact and all of that? We're always very interested in the positive benefits that something that NPF4 will deliver. So could you maybe just shift our thinking a little more towards how we will report on the outcomes and benefits that we see from NPF4?
Sure. So you're right, the delivery plan has got quite a bit of detail in it as to the various aspects and how they're taken forward. A number of working groups working with that and the consultations we've talked about are part of that. But in terms of the monitoring period, as I said in my introductory remarks, and as you recognise, it's probably too early to see things actually delivering. But Craig McLaren, who you had the National Improvement Champion for planning, you had on your evidence session, is working to lead work on a monitoring framework, which helps us understand how the NPF4 is delivering and also how different planning authorities are working with the plan and their effectiveness in the delivery process. And had a good session separately with Craig yesterday. So that is the overarching piece of work, if you like, in terms of how we monitor, and that will come through the process fairly soon. But obviously, stakeholders have got a big role in this as well. So meeting regularly with the heads of planning Scotland and other bodies that got an interest in the planning regime to work with them to help understand how we effectively monitor what the deliverables are from NPF4.
In the spirit of NPF4, do you think, is there a place for the communities themselves to articulate and express what they think?
Absolutely.
Think the success has been, and will we see that kind of stuff coming through to the committee so that it's just not agencies and organisations that are telling us it's working well, but the communities themselves?
No, that's an important part of it, and I think that work's included. And of course, communities have got the opportunity to put forward their local plans for the local area and for those to be fed into the planning consideration through the local development plans at planning authority level, or even just to allow local people to express what they think their local area should look like and for that to be considered in the planning process. So both in terms of engagement for the monitoring and evaluation, but also the broader work as to how communities input to local plans, that's a very key part of NPF4.
I mean, it's year one, so we would hope to see wherever we can a semblance of this stuff coming through, and the committee would take a keen interest in that yearly, as you've said, Ivan. So I'd be particularly keen to see what the communities around Scotland are thinking about how successful it's been. Have you got a sup in that?
I've got
like to ask it just now.
Yeah, convener asking permission for a sup. So just thank you, Willie, for bringing in the desire to have communities be able to feedback. And I just wondered if you had picked up on the work of Planning Democracy. I know that, Andy, you were at that event that they offered, but their proposal around a citizen science type monitoring of the MPF4, specifically the biodiversity aspect. And I wondered if you'd picked up on that and what you thought about actually setting up some way that they could participate in that.
It's an organisation I'd engaged with when I was on the back benches, so familiar with what they're doing, and they've done some thorough work on specific projects, and also as a stakeholder, and I know that officials have met or will be meeting with Planning Democracy to talk about some of the issues, and clearly that plays into the broader policy in NPF4 and about biodiversity and the importance of that, along with climate change, to a central approach to planning going forward. But Andy, do you want to give us a bit more detail on that?
Yeah, just because it was a really interesting session we had in the Parliament with Planning Democracy that evening, and we have looked through the report that's been produced through some feedback from people within communities, specifically around the biodiversity policy. We have reached out to Planning Democracy to offer them a discussion just to go through it in a little bit more detail, but certainly very interesting to hear how local people can feedback their views on what they're seeing happening on the ground and how that might be able to influence future policy and decision making.
Okay, good. That's great to hear that you are taking that forward. Willie, back to you.
Thank you. Just on that very subject, we did hear some concerns, Ivan, about the admin burden relating to some of the requirements on climate and biodiversity. Is that, do you accept, does the government accept that, and what can we do to try and mitigate that?
I think you've always got a balance there, because the value of NPF4 is it covers so many different areas of 32 policy areas, whatever it is. So it has to be overarching and consider all of those factors. But the issue of proportionality is hugely important. So making sure, and I think planning authorities are absolutely seized by that, that the level of information that they are seeking from applicants is very much driven by the proportionality of that. So if it's a householder or a small local development, the requirements will be less than it is for a major housing or infrastructure development. So I think that is recognised within the system to get that balance right. But clearly, as we work through this, it's very important that we recognise that the guidance that comes out takes account of that as well. And of course, a lot of this is about dealing with different cases as they come forward and building up that body of evidence over time, and recognising that proportionality is something that should be leveraged in a way that it isn't a barrier to local communities wanting to take forward their plans.
Okay, thank you for that. We were also hearing that there were some concerns by planning authorities on the interpretation of Policy 5 on soils and Policy 22 on flooding that you mentioned yourself a wee while ago, that the interpretation is very strict and might be leading to actually preventing the deployment of innovative mitigation measures that the communities seek. Is that something that we are aware of even at this early stage, and there's something that the government could do to further engage with that issue?
Absolutely. So Policy 22 on flooding in particular, I'm aware of the work that SEPA has, or their input in terms of specific cases and their general approach to that. It's something that government is engaging with to make sure we've got that in the right place. And going back to your previous comment or question, to ensure that it is proportionate and delivers what NPF4 wants to deliver, but in a way that isn't as you say, mitigating against innovation or development that perhaps should be taking place. So I think it's part of the bedding in process that we're working through that. I don't know, Andy, if you want to comment more on that.
So maybe just say, so there are a few of the policies in NPF4 where we've just found there have been some small sticking points that we've engaged with various stakeholders around. Maybe just mention specifically on policy 22 on flood risk. We have been engaging through HOPS and SEPA, had a sort of few conversations around the handling of that most recently, just a couple of weeks ago as well. Just trying to kind of really get down to the respective roles of SEPA as the government agency being consulted entirely on flood risk matters, but the role of planning authorities as the decision maker as well, having to reflect a much broader scale of interest of policies and helping them to reach their decisions. So we've had several discussions with them now. I think we're getting to a position where SEPA are looking at some guidance that we're just going to see about getting out there fairly soon in terms of their role and how they handle it. We're looking at that alongside the way planning authorities are reaching their decisions, but also the role that the Minister has as well in terms of the notification and potential call-in arrangements for cases where flood risk come into play. We're also planning in the coming weeks to have a follow-up session that will involve some of the industry interests to work things through as best we can.
Thanks for that. I wonder if I could just follow up on that, if you don't mind, either Ivan or Andy or Fiona. A local constituency issue for me, where residents are facing erosion of river banks which adjoin their property. I'm just wondering if the new arrangements, the new thinking, will assist local people to better deal with that, because up until now they have been unable to deal with this and gain permissions from whatever bodies there are in place to help protect their properties that are eroding because of climate change and what's happening out there. So I'm really hopeful that the arrangements in the new framework will allow local people, local residents, for example, to take some action where previously they were unable to do so. Is that the feeling that you get, Minister? That we...
It'd be fair to say, I mean, obviously, I don't want to go into any specifics on individual cases, but I think it's fair to say that is the intention. And as I mentioned earlier, the UK Climate Change Committee's comments around about NPF4 in terms of the contribution it makes to support and adaption. So, as Andy's highlighted, there's discussions ongoing with the statutory bodies around about fleshing out what that guidance should look like, and there's obviously the process that sits behind that in terms of specific applications finding their way through the system and the various ways that those can be considered at different levels in the system. So that's certainly the intention, and it's one of these areas we recognise there's work to be done as that beds in to make sure it delivers the desired result.
Okay. Thanks very much for those answers. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks. I'm going to bring in Gordon with a couple of questions. And Gordon, I think, if you just go ahead and then Miles, I'll bring you in afterwards.
Okay. Right. Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you about the reuse of brownfield sites and what support's available for it. The last numbers I saw was that the amount of vacant land across Scotland had fallen by a quarter between 2016 and 2022. So I wonder if there's any more information you've got on the amount of land that has been recovered and reused. As I say, the last numbers I've got is 2022. However, there are still over 9,000 hectares of derelict land in Scotland. And I'm just wondering, I know NPF4 is only a year old, but is there any incentive within that to encourage developers to continue to use brownfield sites?
So I think, thanks for that data point, one of the things I think we need to do more work on, I've been working with officials on it and recognise that there is a need for more data. I think at all levels to understand what is in the system at various points. And I know that there was some reference to some of that from Tony Kane and others during your evidence session about how much was available, how much was approved through the planning system, how much was getting built on, how much of that was brownfield. So I think there's a need for more of that in the work that's happening in terms of the guidelines on housing land audits will help to make sure that everybody's working to the same set of definitions in terms of pulling that data together. But specifically on brownfield sites, yeah, I mean, the NPF4 recognises that brownfield is preferable. Clearly, that's one of the clear directions within it. Clearly, every bit of brownfield site has got its own specific challenges, depending on where it is, what its history is. Is it need for decontamination? Is there prohibitive cost issues around about it? But clearly, the direction of travel is to bring as much of that back into use as possible. Mm-hmm. The stats you're quoting indicate that is happening to some extent, but obviously there's more that needs to be done about that, and certainly my own constituency is an issue I recognise very well, because it's a considerable amount of ex-housing land and other brownfield sites to be brought back into play. But of course, the NPF4 gives the overarching policies. It's for local development plans and local planning authorities to figure out in their local circumstances what bits of brownfield site should be brought back in and what process is required for that. So in answer to your question, I think we need better data. I think that certainly NPF4 gives priority to the use of brownfield sites. Clearly there's some progress there, but it's very much down to local planning authorities and communities to bring forward what they think to suit the local circumstances.
I know in my constituency and constituencies in and around Edinburgh, we've seen an awful lot of development on good quality arable land. Now, having a policy of brownfield first is great, but is there anything in planning which can halt the building of housing on good quality arable land when there are brownfield sites available sometimes pretty close to the sites that have been built on arable land?
Yeah, but if you look through... So NPF4 highlights that as a policy. The way, and we might go on to talk about this in a bit more detail, but I'm doing the details of this justice, but the process for allocating of housing land has obviously changed in NPF4 from being... having to hit the number, which then encouraged people to bring forward other land that wasn't in the plan, to a process whereby other land will get released if you're using the land that's already in the plan, if that makes sense. So it's quite an important distinction. And that should drive developers and others to make use of land that's in the plan, and clearly a lot of that would be brownfield land based on the local development plans, and clearly the recent court case has reinforced that policy. And as I say, we'll see the appeal process window is still open. We'll see how that transpires. But when you join all of that up, I think we're in a much better place than we were previously, where you've got firm direction of travel, but also flexibility at a local level to take local circumstances into account. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Andy. Okay, thank you. Thanks.
The other question I was wanting to ask about vacant and derelict land was about more than half of it has been suggested that can be developed over the next 10 years. Mm-hmm. However, we know that some of that land has previously been used for manufacturing, mm-hmm. for instance, and will need an awful lot of remedial work. Mm-hmm. Now, we've previously had the vacant and derelict land fund, and we've also had the low carbon vacant and derelict land investment programme. So what incentives are currently available to support developers to reuse brownfield sites?
No, you're right. There's been significant amounts of money available through those funds. But I don't know if you've got the latest position in terms of where we are with the...
There have been quite significant budget reductions in the vacant derelict land fund. I would say that we are looking with the Planning Infrastructure in Place Advisory Group around alternative approaches to supporting unlocking brownfield land. The next meeting of that group will be exploring that. So Clyde Gateway, for example, is a member of that group. So we'll look to them to share experience around that. But it is true to say the regeneration capital grants have reduced as a result of the budget.
Okay, thanks very much. I've got one other question I wanted to ask you, and it's about local place plans. So you know, we had previous evidence that there's only been a handful of local place plans registered. And I know in my own constituency that there are some communities that have the professional expertise to bring forward local place plans, while there are others that do not have that expertise. Is there any plans to support communities to develop plans?
Yeah, I'll ask officials to comment on that specifically, but I think it's important also to recognise that NPF4 is quite clear in terms of those local plans don't need to be an all-singing, all-dancing document. They can just be a statement of what the local community thinks is important to them to include in their local place. And that can be fed in at different stages in the process. It's quite a bit of flexibility to make that more accessible, but I absolutely recognise the point that different communities are going to have different levels of volunteer expertise available to put those plans together and support with that as required.
We don't have specific numbers of how many are being prepared at the moment, but I do gather there are quite a lot of local place plans are being prepared around the country just now. When we brought forward the provisions, and they came through initially through the 2019 Act and the detail and the regulations to follow up, we were very kind of clear that we didn't want to over-engineer the process. It shouldn't be a complex business to produce a local place plan. I do appreciate some of those that have been prepared so far with a bit of professional support are sort of very well put together and sort of quite detailed plans. But a local place plan could be something much shorter. It could be a couple of sheets with a map and some priority commitments made on it. At its heart, what the local place plan is, it's a statement from the community of what it wants to happen in its area, so it can be something far simpler.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks very much. Yeah, that's great to get that clarity on the simplicity. A couple of A4 sheets of paper and a map. Just before I bring in, so we're going to go back to the brownfield. There's a couple of sups on that I wanted, but just before we do that, before we move away from a point that Ivan, you made around gathering data, something that I picked up in conversation with planning authorities is, so something to maybe track is the number of consents. So this is really kind of related to housing, really, but the number of consents that are given, and then is the housing moving forward? And if not, is it, why is it being stalled? So I wondered if you'd give, the Scottish Government could give some consideration to some way that planning authorities can track that and have a kind of feedback mechanism from developers that they can say why they've not actually got on site and that kind of thing, because apparently that's happening across the country and we've got really need the housing to happen. So if consent is happening and that's already a challenging process, but then we're not actually getting the development needed, that might be another one for you to pick up in your data. Tracking.
Absolutely, and I think that whole process all the way through, and I think it was Tony Kane that identified this issue, and as I say, I've been having conversations with officials about how we take that forward. The housing land audit guidance is important because I understand at the moment everybody does it in a different way, so adding it all up at a Scotland level is kind of difficult. So that's the first stage, is to get everybody on the same page on that, and then exactly that, to be able to identify at different stages in the process. I mean, one data point I've got from, and it isn't official stats, it's just pulling together some approximate data, and this is slightly historical, 2018-19, there was land identified as being suitable for housing that could accommodate approximately 390,000 units. So that's a significant number, given we're only doing 20-odd thousand completions per year. So that's how much is in the pipeline at early stage, then how much of that has gone through the planning process we now need to identify, and then exactly as you say, where is that sitting and why has that not been taken forward to the development stage? You know, there'll be a mixture of reasons for that, but drilling down into that I think is absolutely critical to understanding how the planning process is supporting and where the bottlenecks are, if there are any, or if the bottlenecks are elsewhere in the housing provision landscape, round about investment or skills or the attitude of developers or local issues or whatever it happens to be.
Okay, good, great that you're across that. I'm going to bring in Miles on Briggs on a brownfield sup, and then I'm going to Mark Griffin, and then I'll come back to you.
Thanks. It was a wider question with regards to pipeline, because as we looked at MPF4, one of the biggest concerns was over pipeline, and we were reassured that this wouldn't be a problem. Developers are telling us it very much is. And I think one of the things we need to see is NPF 4 has obviously removed the ability to support unallocated housing sites. So just wondered where government are on some of that and whether or not national interim planning guidance could be looked at around some of these sites which haven't been necessarily brought forward.
Right.
To get that balance right across...
So I'll bring in Andy in a minute, sure. But a couple of points on that. I think if you look at policy 16, I think it's 16F, there's some exceptions there that allow unallocated land to be brought into the process, depending on the size of the, I think it's less than 50 units for social housing or other local proposals. And also there's a provision in there, and this gets to the heart of the case we've been talking about, for land to be brought into use when the existing land that's allocated has been developed. So there are ways to work through that stop that being a bottleneck, if you like, or on the provision of a provision of land. So I don't know if you want to give a bit more detail on that, Andy.
Yeah, maybe just a little bit more. And you know, we do have to be careful because this is really at the heart of what the legal challenge was about. So we'll try not to get too far into the detail of that. We have been considering very carefully the result that came from the court recently and thinking about what we do next. So once the legal proceedings are over, we are looking at how we can message the what happens next and get something out there. I think we would have done that irrespective of which way the court judgment had gone, but you can expect to see more from us soon.
Okie doke. Thanks.
I think that data point is really important there because it sheds a light on where the hold-up in the process is and helps us understand a bit better all the different perspectives that people are putting into the mix at the moment.
Yeah. Thanks. Just to carry on the theme of data and research around existing brownfield, and just to ask whether, as part of that exercise, you'll be looking at essentially the age profile of that brownfield land, because you know there is a contention that there is brownfield land that has been designated as effective land supply, but it's been in plans for generations. There's a reason it hasn't come forward. Should we just be saying that past a certain cut-off, actually this isn't effective land supply and we should be looking for other sites to fill that gap? So I'm just interested to know if the research will look at the profile of the age profile of that land.
I think that's an important part of it. So the age profile on brownfield land, but also the age profile on land that's been approved for development but hasn't been developed as well. So I think absolutely understanding as much detail on that as we can get in terms of the age profile by local authority, etc., etc. I think it's also, though, I mean, just anecdotally, some brownfield sites can lie around for a long time and then come into use for various reasons. Either funding becomes available for remediation or technology moves on or whatever it happens to be. And I drive past frequently the meat market site in Glasgow, which has now been thankfully developed after many, many years of lying vacant. So I think that the age is a factor, but just because it's old doesn't necessarily mean that there isn't scope for it to be developed going forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Miles. Oh, sorry.
Gordon,
another. Come on in.
Can I ask just a very quick question?
Yes, go on.
Just on that point of delayed land coming into use, is there any evidence of land banking either by local authorities or by developers?
We don't have the data, and I think that's a key point about getting that data. So as we get the audit, the housing land audit guidance in place, get data back from planning authorities, we'll be able to see where it's sitting and how long it's been sitting for, and that'll give us a better perspective on that. To understand, what is in that pipeline, how long it's been there, and perhaps what the reasons are for that.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Miles.
Thank you. I've got a couple of questions on different topics. The first is around specifically looking towards 20-minute neighbourhoods, and the committee's heard a number of concerns with regards to centralisation of services and commercial pressures on developers at taking forward the realisation of that. So just wondered if there's anything Scottish Government can do to unlock such developments.
So just explain, what do you mean, what concerns?
So specifically, I think, with regards to the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods, and therefore kind of the services which people would have within those. And that actually brings me on to my second question with that infrastructure first approach, so that people have the services on their doorstep. For most developments, that's planned on a phased delivery, but I think looking towards things like schools, GP surgeries, the committee's heard quite a lot with regards to leisure and retail facilities, which sometimes are promised and then not realised as well. So just the MPF4 doesn't seem to have necessarily delivered at this stage some of that community infrastructure.
So there's a number of different things in there. First of all, it's early days, so yeah, we'll share this. And the monitoring framework will help to evaluate what's actually getting delivered there. There is within MPF4 clearly policy on infrastructure first as a requirement, and obviously on 20-minute neighbourhoods. So those concepts are embedded in the planning document, the framework to be considered by planners in terms of local development plans and in terms of planning approvals. Clearly, when you get into infrastructure, there's a whole range of different stuff in there, right? And if it's brownfield site, you may be in an environment where there already are local communities with local services within that close proximity, or if it's greenfield, it could be something that's brand new. Public service provision, be that schools and so on, that would be developed by the local authorities' plans in terms of what they assess the need as being. I don't know, I've had conversations with Glasgow in regards to some communities on this locally, working through what schools are available, how many more places they need based on the new housing development, what that means in terms of either expanding schools or is there sufficient capacity there already because roles are falling elsewhere. So there's clearly the local provision, and that, of course, tied up with local capital budgets. And then in terms of private sector provision, and I suppose that includes GPs, doctor GPs, who are obviously, they've got their own scope to set up their own practice where they want to, but retail, leisure facilities and so on and so forth. That will come down, of course, to the commercial viability of a lot of that, and we're not clearly in a position to mandate people to set up in shops in certain areas, but the provision of facilities is very much included, as I say, with those presumptions on infrastructure first and on 20-minute neighbourhoods in the planning assumptions within NPF4. I don't know if you want to go into more detail on that, Andy.
Yeah, I think this just sums up the importance of the plan-led system that we have, that can just give that bit of certainty about the direction of travel, of sort of where new development's going to happen. That feeds really right through the infrastructure-first approach. If we know where we're going to develop, it allows the infrastructure providers, but also other service providers as well, just to kind of see the opportunity of where they're going to be able to move in with their investments in the future. The next round of local development plans will be really sort of crucial in helping support that move to the infrastructure first.
Yeah, I think for most of us, we can see where potentially new development has resulted in some of the new schools which are needed. But I don't think we've seen that in the sense of GP services. And, you know, I look at my own area here in Edinburgh. 6 or 7 years ago, I asked questions around what investment was needed in our GP surgeries, and £60 million was the figure at that point, which was put forward. Now, we've not seen new GP practices being built, but we've seen huge numbers of new houses, and then those being absorbed into the current GPs. And it does feel like it's at a breaking point in many communities who, you know, quite rightly are campaigning for new practices. And there's a recruitment side to that as well. But I just wondered where the government was specifically looking at the pressures our NHS is facing, especially around A&E, where people go there instead of their GP, and whether or not there is a disconnect in terms of new build housing and then the lack of additional GP capacity being developed. And, you know, these sits within different departments, understand that fully with health and planning, but there does seem to be a specific issue where we've seen a lot of additional homes built.
The planning system obviously doesn't and can't fix all of those issues, and you're rightly identified that there are different parts of government that are responsible for provision of other services, and I don't think we can too much into that. to talk about the cause it's outside the scope of what we're talking about this morning, but I recognise the point you're making. But in terms of what NPF4 can deliver, as I say, it's got that focus on 20-minute neighbourhoods, on infrastructure first, and the importance of that to determining the planning applications and whether they get taken forward or not. And you're rightly identifying, yeah, if there are challenges in other aspects of public service provision, be it health or education, local authorities are tasked with provision of adequate services to do that.
And just finally, in your opening statement, you touched upon this, and I wondered if the government intend to proceed with infrastructure levy legislation in the Planning Act, what's the timescale for that introduction?
Hand over to Andy in a minute to go through the detail on that, but I just had a submission on that from officials in the last couple of days. So we're looking at what the scope of that could be, and we're about to go out to take views on a number of questions around about how it should be levied, what the extent of it, what it could be used for, and a number of other factors. So that's imminent. So.
Yeah. Just to say, really just sort of days away from issuing a discussion paper to really sort of get the conversations going over the course of the summer, just exploring some of the ins and outs of how an infrastructure levy could be made to work. We'll do that over the next few months. We'll can engage heavily on the levy with a view to working up draft regulations and a further consultation paper to come out next year. There is a sunset clause on the levy provisions which expires in July 2026, so we know we need to move that forward just now.
Okay, thanks. Okay. Thanks for that.
Thanks very much, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. And good morning, Minister, and I welcome you to your role. Obviously, you've heard that there's a housing emergency. I was lucky enough to speak to 31 out of 32 councils, and one of the areas that each council brought up was the pressures on housing. And then, obviously, we had the five councils going into the housing crisis. And it's good to hear that the Scottish Government did declare a housing emergency. So my question is around, are you satisfied that the approach to housing to set out in the NPF4 will deliver the homes that Scotland needs? And what more can be done to the planning system to deliver these homes?
Yeah, it's a very fair question. NPF4 is one of its policies and requirements, the overarching principles, the delivery of those homes. So it's very focused on that, as of course you would expect it to be. Clearly, there are a number of other factors involved in that, and we've talked through the different policies around climate change, around biodiversity, and spoken about infrastructure first and 20-minute neighbourhoods are all part of the mix, but absolutely central to NPF4 is having a planning system in place that is able to deliver, support the delivery of those houses to deal with the situation as it stands across the country. And I think we all agree that the solution to that is going to be building more houses across all tenures where they're needed across the country. Clearly, the local plans within that are critically important so that planning authority areas and their local communities have their input as to where those houses should be built, which is a key part of the consideration. But I think the document and the framework as it stands is absolutely focused on how that's taken forward. But clearly planning can only be part of the solution because it's about the commercial aspects, it's about skills aspects, it's about a number of different things that impact housing provision. I know the Housing Minister is very focused on taking forward, and I'm working with them on what needs to be done to help address some of those challenges.
You know, thank you, Minister. Just obviously, the housing emergency is declared now, and obviously the NPF4 is in place. Is there anything that you think that needs to change when it comes down to the planning system that you feel coming newly into your post now?
Well, I think that the piece we've talked about, and we keep coming back to it, on the provision of data is important. So understanding what land is where in the system and why it's not moving through. And is that planning issue or are there other reasons for where planning has been granted that that land isn't moving through to be available for housing stock. So I think that is probably the key area where planning's got a provision, understanding that data, but also making sure that the policies, as they're rolled out, the policies within MPF4 as they're rolled out, are able to support rather than mitigate against housing development, where that's appropriate, of course. And some of the things we've touched on, I think, get to some of those aspects where as more guidance comes through and more engagement happens with bodies involved in the planning process, we'll get more clarity on that to be able to address some of those issues and flesh out in a bit more detail what the policies mean for delivery.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So Gordon, I believe you wanted to touch on this.
Yeah, just a bit of clarification I was looking for. Obviously, the housing emergency that's been declared is predominantly because of the lack of affordable housing. However, in 22-23, we built the most affordable homes since the year 2000. So I'm keen to try and understand what is within the gift of the Scottish Government. We've seen private renters have the housing allowance frozen, and we've seen buy-to-let mortgages go through the roof, and that has pushed up private rents. And we've also had homeowners having renewed their mortgages and seen payments tripling. Can you tell me how much of that is within the remit of the Scottish Government, bearing in mind that any housing emergency is about supply and demand? And secondly, is there still a requirement for developers of private housing to provide 25% affordable homes?
Yeah, the 25% provision is in place, and you're right to reflect on the record, notwithstanding the fact that there are clearly challenges in terms of housing stock provision. If you look at the record of the Scottish Government compared to other parts of the UK, it's considerably more houses have been provided per head of population in Scotland over the last number of years. And obviously the answer to your question in terms of those levers, be it macroeconomic levers around about interest rates or be it around about the ultimate provision of capital investment or borrowing powers to be able to address those challenges on affordable housing stock in particular, is controlled at a UK government. Those issues are reserved.
Thank you.
That was a little bit broader than our MPF4, but I appreciate you answering that, Miles.
Yeah, just briefly, because obviously your portfolio sits between local government and planning, and I was up in Perth and Kinross Council yesterday meeting to discuss some of their housing issues, and specifically around empty homes. And I know here in Edinburgh, my own council, have over 3,000 empty properties, and just wondered where you're trying to connect these two issues to actually provide the homes we need. It's something which Gordon and I have raised this consistently with the council, although we say they don't have the money to bring them back forward, or they haven't audited them in some cases to find out what works need to take place. But given this housing emergency which the government's declared, that seems like a really important starting point to get every home possible back into use.
No, that's absolutely true. And as I said, my colleague, the Housing Minister, is working on a whole range of measures to address this. The empty homes issue is part of that solution. Now, clearly those numbers at 3,000, I don't know the number right across the whole country. How much? 47, thanks for that. So that's clearly an issue that I know is getting addressed. The work on compulsory purchase orders and looking at compulsory sales orders are part of that mix to give the tools and the capability to do that. There are clearly funding issues in that as well, and it's understanding where best to... I know I talk for the housing minister, he'll looking at that himself, but where you focus that that investment in terms of new build, bringing houses back in, a combination of both is clearly required, I would suggest.
Thanks for that. Just on the, you mentioned the CPO, the CPO review, and then looking at the compulsory sales orders. Can you give us a timeline on that?
Yeah, there's a group meeting on that that Rosanna Cunningham is chairing that, yeah, or leading that. And with Fiona, of course. So I'll hand over to Fiona and she can give you an update on where our group's got to.
Yeah, so it's... Again, quite early days for the work on compulsory purchase orders reform. We've had our first meeting of the group, and the group is largely practitioners from public and private sector, because it's quite a technical area. So we've started work on that. We intend to engage with wider stakeholders as that work progresses. The next meeting is next week. We've started to scope some of the issues around that, around the process and how it can be made fairer and faster. We expect there to be an interface between compulsory purchase orders and ideas around compulsory sales orders, and that group may be able to consider whether or not CPO could be an alternative approach to compulsory sales orders. But as I say, it's early days for it.
OK, thanks for that. I just wanted to take us down off the back of that Pam's question on the housing emergency and NPF4. I just wanted to take us down a tributary on rural housing, so bear with me. So a couple of things. One that's been raised to me is that the language around rural groupings and clusters has been removed from NPF4, and that's been raised to be quite concerning because it's because it means that those things aren't identified in NPF4, and therefore it's harder for rural housing to be taken forward. Is that something that's come across? And the other part is also infill sites. Apparently, I've spoken with an architect, design and build company, where they used to work with infill sites and extension sites, and those seem to be, in one particular planning authority, no longer an avenue. And because of that, now three houses are not going to be built. So in detail, but those are, you'll be aware that those, you know, one or two houses in a rural community are quite critical.
No, I absolutely recognise that, and you're obviously right that those small numbers in a community can be hugely important. I'll hand over to Andy in a minute to get maybe through some of the detail on this, but clearly rural revitalisation is one of the overarching principles in NPF4, and we've already talked about the proportionality and flexibility at local areas to be able to have either local development plans or local community plans that recognise local factors and able to support accordingly. So I think that is understood within the framework, but as it's bedded in, if there's issues like this that are raised, they need to be obviously considered and addressed. And I listened with interest to the witnesses you had from Niall and Shear talking about the applicability mm-hmm. of NPF4 locally. So, Andy, I don't know if you want to go into some of the details on those specifics.
Maybe just a couple of points. So, I mean, the NPF4 is intentionally very supportive about rural housing. And the policy intent on Policy 17 talks about encouraging, promoting and facilitating the delivery of more high-quality, affordable and sustainable rural homes. We did have some early engagement through HOPS just around the kind of understanding and interpretation of the policy, just to reinforce the point that it is intended to be a sort of very supportive and positive policy. Another thing thought it's maybe worth a mention is this is one of the areas where we have talked about potential to use master plan consent areas mm-hmm. could really kind of be used in the clustering that you mentioned as an opportunity to allow for build out to come as and when need is recognised. So that's one of the routes we could use to support rural housing in the future.
So do you think that these glitches are something around the need for guidance coming forward on this, what the intention is, because it seems like our local authority has kind of gone away from that and is actually potentially thwarting revitalization, rural revitalization.
Yeah, I mean, it's without knowing the specifics of the case, and there may be other factors involved, but refer back to the fact that, as Andy said, rural revitalisation is a core, one of the overarching principles in the document, and that's clearly one of the policy directions. It's hugely important in line with that policy 17. So if we're finding ourselves in a situation where we're effectively taking a step backwards from things that happened before, I think flushing that out through the engagement work that's happening with stakeholders in the planning community is hugely important to help us understand, does that require, well, the specifics of that, does it require more clarification on guidance, are there specific local issues that affect that? But it's good that these are being raised, frankly, because it allows us to dig through and address, is this working as intended?
Mm. Yeah, another part on rural housing that was raised to me is what happens if your whole, all your area is peat? How do you tackle that one? So, yeah, something else to maybe be gathering data on there.
Yeah, there's clearly some hugely important imperatives round about the climate impact of peat. And I know, again, from Niall and Shea, that I think they gave statistics about how much peat that they have, and it's an awful lot of peat. So that is clearly a factor. But, again, I think that's where the value of the local development plans come into play, because they're able to take into account those factors and understand how that works in a local context. But I don't know.
OK, great, thank you. I'm going to go bring Pam back in.
Thank you, Chair. Minister, we heard in your opening statement how important planning is to the First Minister's plans going forward. We also heard from witnesses that attended this committee and gave evidence that the inadequate resourcing of planning departments remain a barrier to the delivery of the NPF4. Could you outline the proposed changes to funding set out in the investing in planning consultation? And could you also explain how these changes will tackle the resourcing issues?
Yeah, well, I mean, in terms of the resourcing issue, the planning is provided by local authorities and there isn't ring fencing. So they make the decision on what resource they allocate to the planning process. There has been a reduction in resources allocated at that level, as you rightly identify. There's work ongoing at the moment to understand what we should be doing with fees going forward. And there have been increases in fees recently, and there's work ongoing to understand how that should be taken forward. If that brings more money into the system to be able to support planning authorities to have sufficient resource in place. But I think there's a number of other aspects to that as well. There's challenges in terms of number of planners coming through the system. Now, this isn't, you could name 50 different professions where that's a challenge across the whole economy, so it's not unique to planners, clearly, but it is something we are seriously addressing. I was at an event in University of Glasgow last week, so that was a combination of academics who do the training, planning authorities and industry partners all getting their heads around the table to figure out how we improve the flow of planners coming into the system. And government's got to work as contributing to that through some of the bursaries and other support that we're putting in place to support graduate planning roles as part of that education piece. There's also work, and I say I met with the National Improvement Champion for Planning yesterday to understand how we can perhaps use technology to make the process more effective and efficient so that we can get more applications through. I give a number of planners by being more better use of that technology that's becoming available. So there's a number of different strands of work happening there to increase the capacity within the system, but we absolutely recognise that it is a challenge.
Thank you, Minister. I'm going to come back to you on the planning profession side, but can I just probe in something that was brought up in last week's committee? You talk about the kind of fee system. That was something Homes of Scotland brought up and said there's no use charging more fees if basically they are not getting that adequate service. And then what we heard last week, so that was the week before, what we heard last week was that the fee system is ring-fenced. So basically, is that something you're looking at? That was something that was brought up last week.
I think the point is that the fee system isn't ring-fenced. So you're right in terms of the message I get from developers and certainly from industry partners. And just as an aside, part of the challenge, and we're a victim of our own success here to some extent across the whole economy, is that the significant expansion in renewables capacity in the plan further exponential expansion there means that there's a much higher required for planners, and there's a whole industry sector now, the energy sector, that's looking to hire planners, and those are coming from perhaps local authority or other private sector employers. So that is putting further requirement for increased numbers of planners into the system. But the point about fees is that they aren't ring-fenced, so the money goes into the general, or the local authority's general pot, and the local authorities make their own decisions as to what they spend those funds on. And so that link isn't clear. It isn't the fees going to hire more planners. It's up to the local authority what they do with that money.
Shall I ask quickly, 13? Thank you, Chair. I think it was in relation to that, Minister, that they were talking about that the fact that to bring more planners on, that fees, maybe local authorities are ring-fencing it for something else, but it'll be interesting to probe a little bit more into this, which I will do. So it's good to hear that you're saying there's lots of work being done. Obviously, we need to have new entrants coming in, encouraging people to go into the planning profession as well. So we've been hearing over the weeks that basically there is obviously an inadequacy there as well. It doesn't help when, obviously, stakeholders have told us that there are cuts to the college budgets, and obviously that's affecting negatively to the delivery of the skills. So what is it that you're actually looking at with the Scottish Government to encourage new entrants into planning? And are you content that the workforce, that the work that you're doing will deliver the workforce that is much needed now and much needed in the future? Because obviously we're talking about renewables, we're talking about a lot of climate change here. Yep. We need those skills, those transferable skills as well. So what's your
view on that? First of all, I mean, this isn't just a Scottish issue. There's an issue across the whole of the UK on this issue. The workshop last week was interesting because there was a whole range of different things, and it was good with different people from different perspectives coming to the table. I mean, one of the things that came out was, how do you get young people in school interested in planning, and how do you make that an exciting career option for young people to grow up and say, I want to be a planner, which is something that we need to address and take that forward and highlight the fact that in that role you are dealing with issues that are hugely important to individuals and communities and society. You've got a very varied career dealing with a whole range of different policy aspects, and a very fulfilling career as a consequence of that. So there's that piece of making it more attractive for people to come into the process. There's looking at how do you make provision for people to move mid-career that want to go into planning, that maybe got experiences that are in adjacent sectors that they might find that an interesting career transition later in life. You're right on the education side in terms of the capacity that's there. That's an issue. Some of the education providers, University of Glasgow and others, looking at what they can do to help put on provision to help train more planners.
No, thank you, Minister. And I hope that the Education Cabinet Secretary is working alongside as well, so we can work crossover, because planning isn't just the issue, there's education there as well.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Chair.
Thanks, Pam. Before I bring in Mark Griffin, I'm just going to ask a couple of questions around those two areas. So one thing that's come up in terms of the resourcing of local authorities, obviously there's the local authority planning department, but then there's also the statutory consultees who seem to be quite under-resourced. And again, talking to planning departments, it seems that there can be quite a long time before a statutory consultee will get back to them. And I know that's maybe kind of beyond the planning department. You're starting to talk about Nature Scott or SEPA. But I think we need to recognise that planning is part of a bigger ecosystem, and lots of different bodies feed into it. And how do we support the process there? I mean, I know there's, there are some thoughts around streamlining some of the processes. But just, how do we help the statutory bodies to contribute more swiftly?
Yeah, to be honest, I mean, I think you're right to raise that. It's not something I've got data on with me today. It's certainly something I'll commit to go and look at more thoroughly and understand exactly what the challenges are there and how addressable that is. It's something that will be in the scope of the work that I think is in the scope, pretty sure it is, that the National Improvement Champion for Planning is taking forward to understand that whole system, because you're right, you need to get the whole thing joined up and working together. There is clearly requirements or targets in terms of how long it should take for things to go through the process and various bodies to come back on their piece of that. So drilling down a bit more into that, understanding where those bottlenecks are is something I commit to do more work on.
Yeah, something else I brought up with Craig McLaren when he was with us was the whole idea that, he put it back to me as customer care, he called it, but it was basically that people are, architects or developers are putting through planning applications, but then not hearing back in any way, shape or form in a timely manner, or not really hearing back at all. So something there where there's a bit of a better communication system. I know I'm going to use an analogy. I like it when I'm on the train commuting from here to home and we're stopped and the conductor actually tells us why we're stopped. And then, you know, it takes the anxiety and the worry out of why are we stopped here and how long is that going to be. So I think it is that kind of communication piece there. If we could get that into the system, that could help quite a bit.
I think it's absolutely true, and that's a basic principle around about customer service that I've certainly in the public sector and the private sector as well. It's very important to tell customers what's going on and makes them much more comfortable and understanding of the situation. So I think that the work that the National Improvement Champion is taking forward in that framework for evaluation of how different planning authorities are performing is a key part of that. And I know that not just in terms of what they're delivering, but how they engage with customers is a big part of that as well. Yeah.
Great. And then just on the new entrants or bringing more people into the planning department with new entrants or having people who are already in the system training in addition, I think one of the concerns that I think has come up through this series of evidence sessions is actually retaining people in the public sector, because it can be a much more attractive offer to move to work for a private company. So what could we do there, do you think?
Well, I think it's more complicated than that, because within the private sector, there's shortages as well, and different sectors looking over their shoulder at other sectors who are worried about them stealing their people. And I think the fact that we had everybody in the room at this event last week together kind of perhaps highlighted the need for people to work more closely together on some of this stuff. And it may be that there's scope for best to articulate this, if different planners in different parts of the process perhaps doing duplication of work, right, and perhaps the opportunity for some understanding of that across the whole system to make the process a bit more streamlined. This is something I think that people comparing notes on that can perhaps take us to a more effective place. It's one part of the solution, but let's say there's clearly a number of other legs to that as well.
Okay, great. Good to hear that you're across that. I'm going to bring in Mark with a number of questions.
Thanks, Convener. I just wonder what the government's assessment is after the Miller-Moss End ruling as to what effect do you think that's going to have on the number of developments being brought forward and approved?
Okay, so first of all, let's say the case is still potentially live because there's an appeal timeline that isn't timed out yet. So bearing that in mind, it's still early, and I think we're going to, as government, have a look and assess what the implications of that could be. I think it's fair to say that there would be applications that weren't progressed or that were on hold as a consequence of that. So it may be that some of those will start to move, and I'll clearly give some clarity round about how MPF4 in that approach is taken forward in practice. So you'd like to think that what it will do is ensure that the provision of land that's in the local development plans is taken forward based on that ruling. But as I say, it's probably too early, and we need to get our heads on exactly what the implications of that are. I don't know if you want to give a bit more detail on that.
Yeah, maybe just a little more. So the Minister's predecessor, along with the Housing Minister, hosted a roundtable session with the housing sector, so industry and public authorities, last November. And since then, been working up a series of actions of things that we can do really to try and support what planning can do to play its part in the delivery of housing. So we'll be looking to get that back together quite soon to follow up on some of these actions. But beyond that, I would just sort of reiterate the point I made earlier that, you know, once we get to the end of the process of this legal case, we will be able to say a bit more just on what's happening next.
Okay. I wonder if you're in a position to say whether there are any plans through the assessing of that decision, whether any plans to review, you know, policy 16F and MPF 4, even on an interim measure, and given that the data that has potentially been that the pipeline has been assessed against is out of date. So until these new development plans and the research that backs them up come into force, whether there's any plans to review 16F in the interim, if there are any early signs that the ruling is choking off development?
I think the ruling kind of reinforced the application of that policy. I don't think we've got any plans to review it, but certainly watching the data and getting better data to watch is a hugely important part of what we need to do going forward across a whole range of what's in the pipeline. But I don't know if you want to comment any further on that.
I think what you ask there is just part of our consideration of the legal judgment itself and about what we do next. I don't think we're in a position yet to say just what that's going to be. I'm sorry.
OK, the other thing that I wanted to ask about the ruling was that the court considered, in terms of, you know, the exceptional housing land release policy, whether there was still a target in the planning system. And I think the court held that, at least they decided that the MATLR figures was a target. Now, the government contention has always been that MATLR figures, you know, it's in the name, it's a minimum. And that authority should go beyond that. But given the decision of the court, do the government plan to review guidance around MATLR figures to give planning authorities not just the confidence but the incentive to go past the figures in MATLR, especially given the declaration of a housing emergency?
Well, as I think, as you've said, the MATLR figures are an assessment, and they're increased by 25 to 30% to give those MATLR numbers, and then those are seen, as you said, as a minimum. So the expectation, I suppose, is that local authorities are delivering in excess of what is in the MATLR figures. But I don't know if you want to.
That's certainly been our expectation, that they already would deliver in excess of the MATLR. Now, that's just starting to work its way through the new round of local development plans at the moment. But that's our policy position.
Yep. And is the court decision to treat that as a target rather than a floor have any bearing on government's thinking on using those figures going forward?
I think that's part of the consideration we'll look at, but in the round. But I don't see anything else.
The MATLR is the target, as is required by the Planning Act. But although that is an established target, as I say, it's our sort of repeated policy position that we would expect that to be exceeded.
Okay, thanks. So on to a different subject. The Level 4 budget figures for planning state, the planning budget line has fallen by just over 40%. And that is, according to the budgets, because capital investment in digitally transforming planning services has been reduced. I don't know, Minister, if you're able to say what impact you think that budget reduction will have on what we hope to see in terms of digital transformation of the planning system.
So I think it's a couple of things. Are clearly that's the budget that government is spending on work that it's taking forward. It's not the budget for planners and that resource within local authorities, because, as I say, we had that conversation, that's obviously not ring-fenced. There's a focus on the digital delivery plan, which that budget contributes to, and the work there is to take forward the new payment service as a first stage, and then further digital work on the back of that. So there's a plan there as to what gets rolled out as part of that service. And the fact that we've got the National Improvement Champion in place, and again, it's quite a tight team, but they're very, very focused on bringing other partners together. So it's definitely not a big organisation. It's very much about how it engages with stakeholders and identifies opportunities for improvement, which I think is the most effective way to do that. So the point I'm making is there's clear steps in place to deliver on digital and on the improvement work across the whole system.
Okay, thank you. And finally, on the Scottish Government's new national outcome on housing, I think the consultation closes tomorrow on the review of criterion to amend the NPF 4. And I just wonder, given the new national outcome on housing, given the Parliament and Government's declaration of a housing emergency, how those two changes will feed into that consultation on the review of NPF 4?
Well, I think we welcome the fact that there's the outcome on housing is in place, and we've talked about the role of NPF 4 with its... with a primary consideration as to how we build, enable the building of more houses. So I don't know if we'd anything else to say specifically on that. I mean, we're in the process of we've got. I don't think it changes what is in NPF 4 or what the intent of that is, and it's it just kind of gives it more focus. In fact, we've got that national performance framework indicator there, or objective there, and we continue the work of the embedding the process and rolling out and working on the local development plans and all the other elements of that we've talked about this morning.
It was just on, is it not the case that there's a consultation on a criteria to amend MPF4 and that closes tomorrow? So the question was more about whether that new national outcome, whether the housing emergency, whether other directorates in government, how they are feeding that relatively new information into a consultation that closes tomorrow.
So just around the consultation that closes tomorrow, I mean, that's just sort of largely procedural. So what would the processes be for amendments to NPF4 or to the local development plan? With one sort of extra point around the to what extent or at what point would amendments being made to national planning framework trigger a full review of the national planning framework? But as I say, it's sort of largely procedural rather than the content of what an amendment to NPF4 might look like.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Just I've got a curiosity here, sticking with the whole national outcomes, existing ones and potentially new ones. And the and how MPF4 relates with them. I'd be a little interested to hear, certainly with your predecessor, I was in conversations around the gender sensitive planning work that's being done in Scotland, and I just wonder if you're across that, because it seems to me that gender sensitive planning work could help us with the new national outcomes and kind of feed through all those aspects.
Do we have anything on?
So we have a lot of work that we've got under our belts already on gender sensitive planning. We've done really positive events internally within Scottish Government. The Women's Development Network has looked at this. We also held a practitioner session as well that was attended by more than 100 people. And we had a good conversation as well within the Parliament looking at gender sensitive planning. So we think there's a lot of opportunity there for Scotland to show quite strong leadership in this area. And we're working with Dr. May East, who's an expert in this area, to plan an international event, also with Councillor Holly Bruce from Glasgow City Council, who's shown real leadership in this. So that is planned for the autumn, where we'll be able to compare experiences from different countries and cities. So it's a real positive part of the policy.
Thanks for that. And you're kind of seeing how the connection works to the national outcomes through that work.
Yeah, no, it's definitely about that bigger picture for planning and its contribution to wider society.
Brilliant, great, thank you. I just want to bring Willie Coffey back in. He's got, I think, a supplementary on the budget question. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, it's just on the Level 4 budget that was discussed a minute or so ago. I mean, that Of course, that's in two parts, that budget proposal. The item refers to the capital allocation cut, which is principally coming from the UK government block grant cut. Mm-hmm. But the planning resource budget in the same table shows a 39% increase mm-hmm. from the Scottish government, from about 4.7 million up to about 6.6. So there's two sides to a story there. Minister, would you just confirm that that's accurate?
There certainly are, and I would not doubt your figures, Mr. Coffey, so I appreciate you raising that for the committee's attention. I don't know if the officials are across the detail on those numbers.
But, I think okay. we can provide further clarification to you around how the figures have played out on the budget, if that's helpful.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. So that concludes our questions. I think it's been a very useful session. It's great to see that you were paying attention to our previous sessions and pulling through a lot of the conversation there. But also, I think a highlight for me that you set out right from the beginning, Ivan, was the work on data sets and kind of getting that information. And certainly we are planning to do this as an annual event. So there'll be one, at least one more, probably our last one next year before we move to 2026. So it'll be interesting to see at that point what you've gathered in terms of those data sets, but also by then we'll have the planning fees consultation all done and the master consent areas work done. So it'll be interesting to see how those start to kind of come into play with MPF4, but also the other issues that we've raised and that you've certainly, I think, welcomed and taken on board from these sessions. So very much appreciated. Good to see you today. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you very much.
And as that was the final public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of our meeting.